So that's kind of the best I can say about that. But without question, I mean, let me be clear, it is the most lucrative niche in entertainment history. And they keep making movies. But now they're starting to make mistakes because of the truth embargo, the Hollywood big shots, the big-time producers and directors. They don't talk to us. We're not. They don't bring us in and consult, extremely rare. And so they're starting to make mistakes because they don't understand the public's sensibilities on this matter. And it doesn't take much. If you get off in a, you know, to the side and it doesn't resonate, you lose money. Well, they've lost some big money. They came up with a total clunker called Mars Needs Moms, which is just an awful idea. And if they had an appreciation for the contact phenomena and for the abduction phenomena, they wouldn't have made this movie. This movie lost approximately $160 to $70 million, making it the second highest, the biggest loss in box office history, just right behind Cleopatra, and then again, adjusted dollars for inflation. That is a lot of money for Disney to lose, $160 million. And now, they just came out with Cowboys and Aliens. Now, the concept seemed good on the surface. And they certainly had high tech and a lot of special effects, and they brought in some big name actors. But you know, it was still not quite right. And the problem was by hooking it up to a Cowboys, you know, and calling it Cowboys and Aliens, kind of trivialized it. And there's a lot of people out there that now are not particularly comfortable with trivializing the ET issue. Doesn't mean they might not go to a movie, but again, you're getting into some dangerous territory. The movie Paul got into that area, but they managed to pull it off. Cowboys and Aliens apparently didn't, and here's why. It cost $160 million to make, and I'm going to guess the advertising budget was in the $25 million range based on the amount of advertising they've done worldwide, which is just quite extraordinary. That means the movie has got to gross $360 million to break even, and it's going to do about $145 million. So they're going to have to sell an awful lot of DVDs, or they're going to lose, $150, $60, $70 million on that movie. So, you know, what's happening is Hollywood is making the same mistake that the universities and colleges are doing. They're allowing themselves to be bamboozled by the truth embargo. They're making the mistake of thinking that just because the government says that there's not an issue here doesn't mean there isn't, because governments now lie systemically. Lying is practically a fundamental of governance now. I mean, they will lie even when the truth would probably be better serve their interests. So they'd better shape up. They'd better pay attention pretty soon. If they don't start getting some good advice from people who actually know about the real issue, they're going to end up losing a lot of money or stop making any ET-related movies altogether. But there's at least a dozen in works right now. So what can I say? This is where things are with Hollywood. But let me be clear. I am quite happy that Hollywood has had all these films. I'm quite happy that Hollywood has raised public awareness, that it's taken people out into space with extraordinary special effects, so you virtually feel like you're traveling to other planets and you're on other planets. It has broadened the general public's worldview, literally taking it out into the galaxy, which is important because not that far down the line, we're actually going to be going out into the galaxy.
Taking it out of Hollywood and bringing it into the real world.
Mm-hmm.
You're positive our government has UFOs in their possession that have crashed.
The degree of certainty on that is high. I don't think I'd give it 100%, but there's a good deal of evidence, and it's not bad evidence either, that we're flying anti-gravity craft around, saucer-type craft, and maybe triangles. I'd put it up in the 90s. I mean, I could easily say it's 95%. So my confidence is high. It's not quite 100%, but it's close. Now, when you talk about the energy systems, which, of course, these craft have energy systems which are that are outside our parameters. I mean, the energy system of the craft is where the potential breakthroughs could be, the really great breakthroughs could be. There are many speculations about how those craft operate and the kind of energy they are using. They're all legitimate speculations, and there's actually research on this. In fact, there's government programs trying to study, pretty sure, what we think that energy is. the government's keeping pretty tight on that. It's classified. But while the anti-gravitic propulsion would be profound, it would definitely impact the world situations and allow for some, I think, significant advancement in terms of some of the problems we need to face. A major energy breakthrough could be transformative.
Sure.
We don't know how far they've gone with the energy because it's much more difficult to discern it, right? Even if there's a craft up there, and even if it's a human craft, we don't know what energy they're using. And no witnesses that are really tight to that program have emerged. So we're just guessing. But one thing I can say with high confidence is that there's not a chance that they got those craft in their hands back in the 40s and 50s and said, well, we're not going to study the energy. We're just going to, table it or shelf it. I'm quite certain that they have spent billions of dollars and done everything they can to understand the energy systems in those craft. So the question is, how much progress have they made? I think we need to know. And more importantly, if they have not quite figured it out, then the rest of the human intellectual resources needs to be brought to bear. And this thing can't just be left in the hands of a few limited government scientists, primarily mission to create weapon systems. So
you've probably seen the Ben Rich deathbed confessional times. And he says, we already have the means to travel among the stars, but these technologies are locked up in black projects, and it'd take an act of God to ever get them out to benefit humanity.
And he also said we have the means to take E.T. home. I wish he was been more specific. He wasn't.
Yeah.
But there's been other quotes, I mean, allusions. So many high-end people, high-end scientists, high-end military, high-end intelligence.
So you
have made the decision to go along with the truth embargo and take the key stuff to the grave with them. I don't think they're villains. I think they felt it was their obligation, and it was for national security reasons. It couldn't be talked about, but I wish more of them would come forward, and I think more will come forward.
So speaking of quotes, I remember an interview you referred to a substantial prize in this Cracker Jack box, and I think you were referring to all of the benefits that we could get from the re-engineering that you were, or reverse engineering rather, that you were mentioning earlier. What types of technology do you believe that we've taken from these craft, and what do you think we can get from them beyond free energy and propulsion systems?
Anti-gravitic propulsion, and free energy is not a phrase I like to use. It's misleading, and it doesn't really describe anything. Energy will never be free. It will always cost. You've got to move electrons around. You've got to have infrastructure. And so it's going to cost, but the cost could be dramatically reduced. A 90 to 95% reduction in energy costs would be profound. I mean, it doesn't have to be free to be profound. And, of course, a non-polluting energy source of that cost would also be profound. So, I mean, huge numbers of major issues would easily be dealt with in a short amount of time. So those two in and of themselves, enough to keep us busy for the rest of the century. There was other tech in those saucers, and the best, the most important source on that, though it's muddled, was Philip Corso. He tried to rush a memoir out with a co-writer back in 97. It was late in his life. He was suffering from heart issues. He was on medication, so it was kind of tough, and it was messy. But the basic message was that he was aware of the technology that had been some of the things that had been pulled out of that craft, and that he was actually tasked by General Trudeau while he was at the Foreign Technology Desk to see if they could seed some of that into American companies that were working on similar stuff to see if they'd give him a little help. I think the implication was they didn't actually take any hardware to them, but they gave them the ideas in writing, I guess, stating that they were the stuff had come from foreign, quote, technology, meaning the Soviets or what have you. Unfortunately, in the book, which he did not write, I'm quite certain he was telling the truth, but I just don't think it had quite the impact. He was referring to commercial companies, basically, in a sense. What was given to government defense contractors working under extreme classification for weapons, we don't know. And, of course, just because they haven't allowed the energy and the advanced propulsion of those craft to be made available to the public domain doesn't mean the ideas have not maybe been moved around a little bit. So one day, post-disclosure, we will probably learn the pretty good picture of how the ET technology, one way or the other, affected the second half of the 20th century.